Do you know what? It gives me anxiety when people don't have the seatbelt on.
Really?
Yeah, it's funny because I'll stick anything up my nose or in my veins. But you've got to put your seatbelt on. Did you get that? Roll on. Seen it. Shot you. And take that, of course. Signed by me. You ready? I can't remember a thought before wanting to be on stage or perform. When I could walk, I danced. When I could talk, I tried to sing. And if there was more than two people in front of me, I tried to perform in one way or another. My memories of auditioning for Take That were turning up with my mum, and then there was somebody else that was being dropped off by the mum on the other side, and it was Mark Owen, and he was going, "Oh, get away, mum." That was the second audition. The first one was a preliminary audition where I had to go in and sort of meet Nigel Martin Smith at his office, who was the manager of Take That. And apparently the story goes, Nigel was underwhelmed with the interview with me. But as I left and I looked back at him as I was closing the door, I remember this. There was this awkward moment where I didn't know what to do. So I just winked at him. And apparently, if I hadn't have winked, I wouldn't be where I am today. Because he was like, he's got something. So without that moment, things could have been very, very different.
I wake up in the morning pinching myself. Mm. Is this really happening? And it isn't.
To be honest with you, I am from the north. We do two things really well up there, which is kindness and violence. So when I came down to London, I didn't naturally assimilate with the place. I kind of bumped into London and I kind of like broke it early doors for me. I've always had that relationship with it. It's like, that's the place I came to and went to hell. I have an odd relationship with an awful lot of things, an awful lot of people and an awful lot of places, as you may be able to tell. So London's an odd one for me.
Can you talk us through some of your favourite tattoos?
My favourite tattoo at the moment is my Teddy tattoo, done for my firstborn, Teddy. I'm loving my Archangel Gabriel magic sigil. Obviously, Burslem, born and bred, where I'm from. I'm definitely a Stokey. My Morecambe and Wise one, I love Morecambe and Wise. The Take That symbol, bit of Jesus, the weird relationship you have with religion. Born and raised a Catholic, then lost my religion. When you start seeing YouTube videos about atheism, and you go, yeah, I'm that. And then after a while you go, actually, not, I kind of love Jesus. Not in a religious way, I just dig Jesus. I have no brain for numbers and dates. I've got dyscalculia. Well, I don't know if dyscalculia's got anything to do with the fact that I can't remember our anniversary date or my wife's birthday or any of the kids' birthdays. I get in trouble for it, even though it's not my fault. So I was at an optician's once with Teddy and Charlie, the two oldest, and the optician went, "So, date of birth?" And I went, "No, no, because I didn't want to, in front of the kids, say that I didn't know what it was." And I was like, "Oh, just got to go to the loo." Made a quick phone call, and I thought, that can't happen again. So, jotted down the birth dates of the kids. But I read them backwards too, so I'm still getting it wrong. I haven't felt like a home since I left Hillbury, Greenbank Road in Stoke-on-Trent in Tonstall in 1995. When you go around the world and you do these big shows, and you get so much love from stadiums full of people, and you return and you get that love again, you feel as though you kind of belong to them too, in the best way possible. You know, there's a bit of me that's Austrian, and there's a bit of me that's German, and there's a bit of me, definitely a bit of me that's Australian. I kind of feel like I belong to everyone and I belong everywhere.
Right, let's get into the documentary, which I've seen and it is brilliant. Tell us what's different about this documentary.
At the start of the process, I was terrified that this documentary was just going to be talking heads, random footage, and be a copy of everything that you've seen before. I really didn't want that. In the Netflix meeting, at the end of the meeting, I was like, by the way, and I seriously meant this, it was like, whoever it is, can they polish a turd? You know, I just was like, can they make something good out of this? It's my own belief in myself and my story. It's not, you know, it's not gigantic. I definitely wanted it to break form from the norm, and it definitely has.
Robbie Williams is playing three nights at Knebworth back-to-back.
So you've described Knebworth Park as the best show in the world. The record of attendance of 375,000 fans over three nights in August 2003 has never been broken in the UK. How does it feel 20 years on to know that that record is still intact?
Well, I'll only know when that record isn't a record anymore. It just feels incredible to have that have happened to me. Not the record itself, just the fact, you know, playing Knebworth, looking out at a sea of people, having three nights of those, that sea of people. A lot of nice things, a lot of incredible things that have happened to me that you just put in your backpack of, I don't know, self-love. When the negativity is chattering up there, there's these things that you sort of lean upon to go, yeah, well, you can shut up because that happened. It's a useful tool to remember that, you know, these things existed and have existed, and they happened because of me. Yeah, incredible.
You seem more at peace in the documentary than you do in some of the early footage. What was it like watching so much old footage of yourself?
Yeah, it was a trauma watch, to be honest with you. It's like going to the scene of the accident and then having to talk about it for 5 hours a day. I'm sure that on some level, it's a process that was necessary for me. I don't understand why right now. Other than the glory of it being on Netflix and people's eyes being on me again. On some spiritual level, I'm sure that it's done more good than harm, but I'm still trying to figure out why.
You've sold over 75 million records.
No, I've done more than that.
You've sold more than...
I've sold over 100 million records.
You've sold over 100 million records.
Thank
you. You are record-breaking constantly, yeah. But you still have self-doubt, you've referenced it. Do you think that will ever go away?
I think that the self-doubt lessens over time, and it's not, it's still in the car, but it's not driving the car anymore. Where it used to sort of drive the car and head to a cliff, now it's in the back seat, and I'm driving the car. Yeah, but it's a powerful tool. You know, it's a powerful tool that it gets you places. The Netflix documentary about me is currently out. I think that a few of you might have a bit of misconceptions about me, or conceptions that are spot on. And I would love you to go and watch it. And if you do, thank you.